Good morning, everybody. Hope you're all having an exciting Thursday morning. I'm your host, Aditya, and I'm back with another episode of The Weekly Show with Aditya. So the first test match between India and Australia has begun on an exciting note, though somewhat disappointing for the Indian team, as Indian team finds itself at 166 for 6 in 65 overs. As we see Ashwin and Pujara at the crease, this is the post-lunch session, the post-tea session, and it's been an exciting morning. Though 4 of those 6 wickets were as a result of poor batting. They did not allow themselves to settle down and just went playing shots after shots. And it's only been Pujara who scored almost one third of the runs that India find themselves above 150, because at one moment it looked as if they would be bowled out for under 100. But contribution from Pant, Ashwin, bit of Rahane and Rohit Sharma, India are slightly in a position where if they can make around 250, it would turn out to be a very, very good score, considering that Australia's batting is also inexperienced and they will face 3 equally potent bowlers along with Ashwin. Now, both the teams have gone with a 3+1 combination, that is 3 fast bowlers, 1 spinner, and they have gone with a 5th bowler or a part-time 5th bowler, if one has to be clear about it, in Rohit Sharma. It remains to be seen how will Virat Kohli use Rohit Sharma so that his 4 main bowlers are not injured. Just like Tim Payne, the Australian captain, is forced to use his bowlers in longer spells and for longer periods of time. Since Hardik Pandya was not available, India had no option but to go with an extra batsman, and they had to choose between a Hanuman Vihari and Rohit Sharma. So Hanuman Vihari would have been a better option. We had seen Hanuman Vihari and his exploits in the final test match against England, where he scored those 56 crucial runs along with Jadeja in a partnership of over 100 runs. Now between the 2 spinners, Ashwin and Jadeja, the both spinners are equally good and they are all-rounders in their own capabilities. Jadeja would have been a better option because he is a much better fielder and he can give that left-handed option which India had only in Rishabh Pant. But there is no use talking about this as the match is already more than one. We're just an hour away from the end of day's play and the decisions have been taken. Now, whom did they choose and why did they not, and who were left behind? That's a question which, even if asked, will have no impact on the match. Now, looking at the pitch and the ground, 400 or 300 seems way too far. Unless Ashwin and Pujara can do something special and get them to 300. But anything between 250 and 275 will be considered a match-winning score. A score which Australia will have to work very hard to get those extra runs. At 6 for 171 with Ashwin on 15 and Pujara as always the rock on 64, which Rahul Dravid did for best part of 16 years and what Pujara has been emulating, though they are 2 different individuals and they need their own time to develop. But at this point, it's Pujara's score which has taken him onto a very good situation at 6 for 171. We may feel that the score is not enough, but India have 4 equally good bowlers. You have Bumrah, you have Mohammad Shami, Ishant Sharma, Ashwin, and if needed, they can even ask Rohit Sharma or in a surprise move, even Virat Kohli could find himself bowling a couple of overs if he needs to make sure that none of the 3 fast bowlers who are prone to getting injured suffer that fate. Because the option of 3 plus 1 is always a tricky one, though I would have preferred 3 plus 2, but then whom we have left out? Because in the South Africa test matches, they left out Rahane and they regretted that. And here they had no option but to choose Rahane and Rohit both. Now this test match is very, very similar to the one in Johannesburg later, which happened in January this year, where India made around 180 and they went on to win the match, though by a very narrow margin. Batting first always helps the team. Though India needed someone like a Sam Curran to score those 70-80 runs. Can Ashwin be that factor who can score those 30-40 runs and then bring confidence into his bowling and pick up 3 or 4 wickets? He's always been a good batsman. He can score those 30 runs. That is never been the doubt. But his record, or the record that is shown tirelessly by statisticians all over the world, that he hasn't contributed as a bowler outside India. And he's been compared with Nathan Lyon most of the time. The Lyon and Ashwin are two different individuals. And what Ashwin has in batting, Lyon lacks. Ashwin has an extra factor in batting along with Jadeja. The spinners can bat, bowl, they are good fielders. Ashwin can be at slips, he can be at leg slip or wherever required. Lyon is also a good batsman, but you will not see him coming before number 11. So India does have a good batting lineup. And this is the last pair. They have already added 44 runs. And if they can stretch this, we have around 23 overs left. And if they can stretch this by the end of the day, if India can be. So we are back live in the match as Nathan Lyon gets ready to bowl to his off-spinning counterpart in Ashwin. And now it remains to be seen that what Ashwin can pick up those subtle variation as Lyon bowls. And Ashwin puts it away towards square leg for a single. And the score moves on to 173 for 6, 68.1 overs. The Lyon-Ashwin comparison is not a new one for an India-Australia spin comparison, because they had the same between Shane Warne and Anil Kumble. The big difference between Shane Warne and Anil Kumble was that Shane Warne never got to be the captain of his team, while Kumble got a chance to be the captain for at least a year. He became a captain as Pujara defends towards short leg, nicely played on the back foot. It's a good delivery, bit of spin, and Pujara plays with a soft hand as he bowls the third ball. Once again, Pujara gets on the back foot and puts it away, and they will now come back for two runs as India's score now moves on to 175 for 6. At this point, Australia would be thinking, we should have bowled them out by now. But no, the contributions from Rohit, Pant, and Ashwin has taken them to 175 for 6. At 44 for 4, they had no chance. They had no right to make 175. But yes, right now this partnership looks very, very good. As Pujara drives and beats mid-on, and they will come back for 2 runs once again. And they might even come back for 3. Excellent running by these two. As they are not known for their running between the wickets, but right now they have managed to convert this into 3 runs, and they have brought a crucial partnership of 51 runs. A partnership which will go a long way in determining how much India can score and how much Australia will regret not having a fifth bowler. Because if either of these two get out right now, what we have incoming is Ishan Sharma, Mohammad Shami and Bumrah. And neither of those two give you the confidence that they can bat. Shami is going to come and hit blindly without thinking, as Ashwin plays this straight to the fielder, no runs. Ishan Sharma would make one run of 30 balls, and Bumrah, well, he's on the bowling side. Let's not talk about his batting at this point of time. So this has been a good session for India so far. 13 overs, 35 runs, and crucially, no wickets as Hazelwood continues to bowl to Pujara. And this time, a short delivery and he lets it go. Now, will Australia think that if they had that fifth bowler, they would have done better? Or can they use one of their part-time bowlers in better fashion? Because it seems as if the fast bowlers are tiring out and they're trying short deliveries because they have been all the four fast bowlers have bowled over 17 overs each and they are forced to bowl more because, as it has been reiterated, a fifth bowler is missing. Pujara plays defense nicely. Because in the morning they were all bowling above 140 kilometers per hour. Now the speed has gone into the 130s. And they still have 90 overs to go before we can come to the end of day's play. And if in those 90 remaining 21 overs, India can score those 40-45 runs, means they would have scored around 225 today. And if they can stretch that, which is a far-fetched idea, but if they can stretch that to somewhere around, as I've been saying right from the start, between 250 and 275, as Pujara lets his ball go between 250 and 275, the Australian batting will be under pressure. If India scores around 275, it may not look like a winning score, but at this point of time, anything is possible. We have seen what happened in England as England defended close to 300 in the Test Series against India, and then when they went to Sri Lanka, how those crucial partnerships between Butler, Stokes, the contribution from down the order, as England went with three spinners, three fast bowlers, and they even had three wicket keepers in the same team. But most teams don't have that option, as Pujara plays straight to the fielder, no runs. So Pujara has been that rock which was expected of him, and he was expected to face some brick bats, but now those brick bats will be focused on KL Rahul, at some expect on Ajinkya Rahane and Murali Vijay, because they did not survive. And Pujara has led by example that if you can survive in these conditions, you can score runs. And 70 or 184 balls is more than welcome after what the rest of the batsmen did. Though according to me, KL Rahul, even if he doesn't score, he should play the entire series because he is a very good batsman, an excellent opener, and somehow the pitches will get better in the next match. And the win in the first match might help them to play well in the inaugural test match or a maiden test match at Perth. And the Perth match moves from the Wagha to the aptly named Perth Stadium. But coming back to this match, we see how Tim Payne is trying. The captain is trying to rotate his fast bowlers. He doesn't want anyone to bowl more than what? As Pujara flicks it away towards the fielder and they come back for two. As this partnership now goes to 53 and the score after 70 overs, 6 for 180. So we are back live as Ashwin flicks it away past leg slip and he will come back for excellent three runs. Well done. This is the second 3Ds we have taken. Two individuals not renowned for their running between wickets, because Ashwin is a slow runner and Pujara's knees have been his Achilles heel, literally. But now this partnership is beginning to frustrate the Australians and giving a candle of hope, a light, giving a hope that they can cross that 200 mark. Batting first always helps, and who knows, 250, 275 might be a psychological score. So that's a long way to go. You still have 20 overs to negotiate, and anything is possible in that time. We might see Pujara getting out the next ball, as Pujara flicks it away, but straight to the fielder, no runs. So he is beginning to get aggressive. He scored 71 runs, and if he can score that 100, It is possible that it could be the only 100 of this match. So the only batsman who can match Pujara like for like And Australia's thing is Usman Khawaja, who took the brilliant catch at gully of Virat Kohli. So one thing is for sure, that with this performance by Pujara, we can safely say that the dependence on Kohli is not as one thought, or as not as one it was on Tendulkar years ago. We have focused on Kohli so much that we have deliberately forgotten the others who have been equally potential and potent. Full of potential and potent. Changeup bowling as Patrick Cummins comes back into the attack. A young man who made his debut 7 years ago at the age of 84. He was sidelined for almost 5.5-6 years. And he will be an important mark. He will be an important factor in this team, as the partnership between Pujara and Ashwin extends to 56 runs, the highest partnership of the series, and something which the dressing room and our coach and captain in Ravi Shastri and Virat Kohli will have some breathing space to decide, as Ashwin plays it nicely to the fielder, but no runs. So 71.2 overs, 183 for 6. As we continue to see how the captain is supposed to rotate his three fast bowlers and make sure that neither of them find themselves on the physiotherapist's bench, tired, not having enough juice to bowl tomorrow. With temperatures touching 40 degrees in Adelaide and no chance of rain in this match, a result is possible. And at this point of time, it's a 50-50 situation. Ashwin plays it beautifully towards square leg and India's score moves on to 184 for 6. So as I've been saying, 184 at this point may not look like a very, very tall task, but it's a good score. As Lyon continues to bowl to Ashwin, Ashwin on the back foot and single not taken. So catching is going to be a key element in this match. That if you are able to take those close bat-bat catches or the catcher in slips, the team that takes the most catches and takes the most wicket in the most obvious manner is going to have an upper hand. Ashwin plays it straight to cover, no runs. This is a very good contribution, scoring 21 runs of 68 balls. Now one hopes that he can translate these runs and take wickets, just as Nathan Lyon has done for his team. As Ashwin plays on his pads, and interestingly today, neither of the teams have had to take any DRS today because there haven't been any LBW decisions or caught behind decisions so far which have created doubts in the mind of the player or the umpires. Ashwin plays on the back foot but straight to the fielder, no runs. As Lyon comes on to bowl another ball, the last ball of this over, as Ashwin plays straight to mid-on, ends the over at 6 for 184. All the wickets that fell today, the first four wickets, all the batsmen were fishing outside the off stump and driving it to the keeper or slips. Though Kohli's was a result of a brilliant catch and Rohit Sharma's wicket was more of, well, a bit of bad luck. The ball could have gone for 6, but he didn't get the elevation, and Pant was basically the first batsman who actually defended and got out. So that's an infraction in the whole match. Now we are back after the drinks break, and 73 overs, Australia are 6 for 184. And still 17 and a bit overs remaining in tonight's play. As Patrick Cummins steams in to bowl to Pujara, and Pujara defends solidly on the front foot. One can see the speed difference and the intensity of the bowlers as bowling more than 15-16 overs each has taken the life, has squeezed the life out of them, and a fifth bowler's need is being felt right now. But they cannot go back and they have to do with what they have, as Cummins steamed in one again and Pujara plays it nicely for a single, and India's score moves on to 185-6 as Ashwin comes to the crease to face Cummins. Cummins bowls to Ashwin, Ashwin defends, and India's score remains at 185-6. Welcome back, everybody. India just lost the wicket of Ravichandran Ashwin as India's score moves on to 199-7. Ashwin was out after Patrick Cummins bowled beautifully and he was caught at slip by Peter Hanscom. And then Ishan Sharma came and played a beautiful sweep shot to take India's score ever so close to that psychological 200, which at 44-4 did not look like India would reach to 200, though they are 7 down. And yes, more contribution from batsmen could have help India get to a better score, but at this point in time, 200-7 is a very, very challenging score on this wicket. As Cummins steams in, bowls the bouncer, Ishan Sharma plays it away, ends the over, 78 gone, it's 7-1. So the crucial 200 comes up for India as Pujara plays away Nathan Lyon and moves on to 80 of 207 deliveries. As India's score moves on to 201-7. This time Pujara flicks it away and they will try and come back for 2 once again. Excellent running between the wickets. Well done by Ishan Sharma. We remember how Ishan Sharma and Pujara helped India get 2 total, did well in that match against England in the fourth test, when Pujara and Ashwin combined for a partnership. Everyone will be crucial in the context of this tournament, though we see substitutes on the field as Pujara is being helped by the still 11 overs to go before the end of day's play, as Pujara flicks it away on the other side and they will complete the over at 206-7. 79 gone, it's 206-7. The Australian captain is forced to bring on his fifth bowler. Essentially, one would call him a part-time bowler, but it was needed in this situation. And that means if Travis Head is going to be a regular to keep the four main bowlers fresh, it means even Kohli might be forced to bring on someone like Rohit Sharma to bowl. So I was going to see a similar situation. Good over, NZ over, it's 7-206 after it. Well, Mitchell Starc with a new ball has got Ishan Sharma, as Ishan Sharma was trying to fend the ball and he's been hit on the pads, and now India has gone for a review. Australia has already lost a poor review through a poor call, and let's see what happens. Australia took the new ball straight away and gave it to their most potent weapon, Mitchell Starc. And now we wait for the review, as it's a legal delivery through a no ball. That's way behind the line. That's well bowled. Now the question is height. It struck him on the pads. And Ishan Sharma is a tall man, so maybe the height of the ball might help him, or this could be umpire's call. It remains to be seen. It was struck in line, pitching in line, and wickets missing. Excellent call by Ishan Sharma. The height along with the bounce helped him evade this decision, and India retained their review. That was a brilliant decision by Ishan Sharma, considering that he is the most experienced bowler in the team with 88 matches. And this is his fourth tour to Australia, beginning as a 19-year-old in 2008 and now as a 30-year-old in 2018. So this was struck in line, impact in line, But the bounce in Australia saved Ishant Sharma. If this was India, then this would have struck him. It was struck him on middle and leg, and that would have been plumb. As he bowled, this time once again appeals, but this is going down the leg side. So the new ball is heavy, and it with the new ball, India might look to get some runs. And the longer Ishant Sharma is able to support Pujara, the more runs they can score. As we see the previous delivery where he was struck outside leg and it was missing, and they decide, obviously the review would have been wasted. Ishant and Stark, like for like, tall, fast bowlers bowling above 140 kilometers per hour, swinging bowlers. This time he bowls down the leg side and ends the over. It's 81 overs, it's 7 for 206. So we start the 82nd over at 7 for 206 in 81.2 overs, as Josh Hazlewood joins his new ball partner, Mitchell Stark, with Pujara on 85 and Ishant Sharma on 4. Pujara bowls, Hazlewood bowls, and Pujara lets it go outside the off stump. Hazlewood continues bowling 81.4 ball, and Pujara flicks this ball away past mid wicket, and they come back for 2 runs, and Pujara moves on to 87. So as long as Pujara is at the crease, India have a chance to scoring around 250. If Australians are able to get Pujara out, then the incoming batsmen in Mohammad Shami and Jasprit Bumrah are not expected, nor do they want to bat. So Ishant Sharma has to support Pujara for as long as possible. And if they can stretch this till the end of the day's play, and if India can get to around 230, it will be an excellent effort. This time Pujara drives past covers as the ball goes past covers. Sean Ma, Aaron Finch, the one day captain, cleans up, and they come back for one, and they score one run in that. He takes the single of the last ball, of the second last ball. That was a very smart decision. Pujara, who has batted with Ishant Sharma once before in England, and they have complemented each other in this. Now all Ishant has to do is defend this ball so that Pujara can face Mitchell Stark in the next over. And this time Ishant plays well, ends the over, it's 7 for 209. We start the 83rd over, and Pujara this time doesn't take the single. So the plan now is that he would take the single of the fourth ball of the fifth ball of the over and allow Ishant to play the last ball. This time he plays through that vacant gully region and doesn't take the single. Now either Australia can get Pujara out, or they need Ishant Sharma on strike for at least 3 of the 6 deliveries. This time Pujara plays and he still refuses the single. Well, he takes the single this time, moves on to 89. Well done. So this is reminiscent of what happened in England a couple of months ago, when these two combined in a partnership to take India's total onto a respectable score, as India had taken lead in that match. Now more Pujara and Ishant frustrate Australia, more the Australian captain will be forced to retain his fast bowlers and make them bowl more. This means that the fast bowlers will be tired, as there are only 3 fast bowlers, 1 spinner, and Travis Head has come and bowled, but he has been coming in patches. This time Stark bowls but goes down the leg side, and Ishant Sharma lets the ball go. Stark bowls to Ishan Sharma and he's bowled him. Straight full yorker and maybe the decision to take a single early didn't work for India and India lose their 8th wicket and are in the danger of being bowled out today. As Ishan Sharma was the last solid batsman you could have expected him to play for a while. Though this partnership of 21 helped India go past 200, which was a beautiful swing delivery, takes middle and leg and middle and off and Stark strikes to get his second wicket. So all the fast bowlers are now on par with 2 wickets each. Ishan Sharma departs for 4 and India are 8 for 2-1-0. Pujar has moved on from 89 to 99 with 2 billion shots with a 6 and a 4 as India move on to 8 for 224 after 84 overs. Now it remains on Mohammad Shami how he can negotiate that over from Mitchell Stark. The Mohammad Shami has a boundary to his credit and if Pujara can get 100, it will put critics to shame. As he looks for his 16th test match 100 and has completed 5,000 runs in 65 matches, close to an average of 51, joins the list of famous Indian batsmen who have scored 5,000 runs and is now all set to make a legacy of his own. Now it's up to Mohammad Shami how he can negotiate this over from Stark. Shami tries to cut and misses. He has to be very smart on this Mohammad Shami and not play any rash shot because the incoming batsman is Bumrah and there are no two other bowlers who bowl the yorkers best than Bumrah and Mitchell Stark. But when faced with yorkers, fast in-swinging yorkers, they probably might not be able to play it well as they do not allow the other batsman to score. So Mohammad Shami out to face his second delivery of the over and this time he guides it between the slip and gully for a single, which means Pujara is on strike on 99 looking for his 16th test match 100 and some resemblance of hope in this test match. So we wait as Pujara is batting on 99 facing the world's fastest bowler in Mitchell Stark. And has he got it away? Yes, he has. He comes back for a second and scores a 16 test match 100. And what a way to begin a series. And what a way to announce yourself to those critics who had doubts on him scoring hundreds. This is indeed a masterclass 100 as he combined well with the likes of Pant, Ashwin, Rohit Sharma as he saw wickets fall around him, but he kept his cool and composure and has finally his hard work has composed into a brilliant 100. This time Pujara cuts and gets 2 more runs as India's total moves on to 8 for 229 as we see Pujara flick the ball away past the fielder and get to 100. Now if India can stretch this total into the 230s and 240s, one might feel that this could be a respectable score with what's to come in the Australian batting lineup. As Pujara gets to face the 5th delivery of the 85th over, this time he pulls it away and he will get a single, which means Mohammad Shami has one ball to negotiate in this over. So Mitchell Stark gets ready to bowl to Mohammad Shami. He will be looking for those in-swinging yorkers for LBW or bolts, or maybe a bouncer to go past his glove and take the edge of the glove into the keeper. This time he bowls down the leg side, not exactly what he wanted, ends the over, it's 8 for 2-3-0. So with just 4.5 overs to go, the play has been extended by 30 minutes to complete the 90 overs. And this is a result of having only 4 fast bowlers, because there was no delay due to rain or bad outfield or any of those reasons. But the fact that fast bowlers take more time to bowl an over, and they haven't got enough spinners or slow bowlers to counter this. And India will also have problems with their over rate, and this will be a recurring situation in this test match. As Hazelwood comes on to bowl and Pujara pulls it away for a single and has decided to give Mohammad Shami 3 balls to face. Now, will that work in the favor or against the plan? But he trusts Mohammad Shami to play these 3 balls without playing any arrogant shot. Shami, who has the propensity to hit every ball for a 6, this time defends well, as every run is crucial, and a score near 250, as told earlier, will have some impact in this match, as Indian bowlers will have something to defend. We have seen that already in the test against South Africa, where they defended 187 in the first innings, as Hazelwood bowls and Shami, as it is wont, tries to go for a big heave, but the ball goes nowhere. It hits him on the helmet and just pops back. Now Pujara has walked up to Shami to tell him to curb his natural instincts, to curb his enthusiasm. This time the previous ball hit him squat on the shoulder. He needs to be careful. He is a fast bowler. He cannot afford any recurring injuries, since they are only going with 3 bowlers and 1 spinner. As Mohammad Shami gets ready to face the last ball of the over, this time well defended, ends the over, it's 8 for 2-3-1. As Stark gets ready to bowl another over, and Pujara just defends it away. Now with only a couple of overs to go before the day's plays comes to an end, it has been a day, you can say, of disappointment but elation with respect to Pujara's brilliant 100. Now, the Indian bowlers will have to bowl well to restrict the Australian batting. How they do it will be an interesting thing to see, as Stark bowls to Pujara and Pujara just defends it towards point and doesn't take the single this time. So the Indian captain and the coach will be disappointed with the batsman, as Pujara showed how to play, and you don't have to score off every ball if you can score those 100 runs. Stark gets ready to bowl the third ball, and Pujara this time goes over the top of a vacant mid-on, and they will come back for 2 runs. That's nicely done, as India's score moves on to a crucial 233 for 8. This has been a good session, that 30 overs have been bowled, 30.5 overs have been bowled. They managed to score 90 runs and just lost 2 wickets. This time he cuts it away, and that's the second boundary of the over. From 44 for 4 to score 244 for 8 could be a recovery of sorts, though the day is 50-50, as both teams have been relentless, as the Australian fast bowlers with only 4 available today bowled well. The fast bowlers bowled 20 over each, which is a lot to bowl in this heat of 40 degrees Celsius as Shami faces Hazelwood and he takes a single and India score moves on to 244/8. If India can, and we are just 6 runs away from a very, very good, from a very well scored 250, it means Australian batsmen will have to work equally hard to score those runs, and the Indian bowlers now have something to bowl to, and one hopes that they do not allow someone like Pujara to score the 100 or allow partnerships, because Australians might have thought they might have got India out under 100 at 44/4, it certainly looked like that, but at 244/8 we have other ideas. As Pujara flicks this away and he will try to come back for 2 runs, that's another excellent running between the wickets which has been the feature of his batting, and he has also been aggressive when the need comes to be. When push came to shove, he has hit 2 sixes, which is unlike Pujara. This time Pujara uppercuts and they will come back for 2 runs once again as India score moves on to 8/248. Suddenly he has gone into a one day mode which he is not familiar with, but he knows that every run is crucial at this point. So any runs through any means will be useful, as he has scored 50% of the team's total, and the second best score in this situation has been 37 by Rohit Sharma. As Hazelwood gets ready and Pujara now looks to score as many runs as possible. This time Pujara goes, beats mid-on, and they will get the crucial 250. That's well done. That's really well done. After what we saw in the opening match, opening session, in the 250 might just be that psychological barrier breached which they were looking for, and it has been done courtesy a brilliant 124 by Che Pujara, as this was nicely played straight down the ground. As Pujara gets ready to face another ball, he has moved down to 123. India are 8/250. We are 2 balls away from finishing this over and taking advantage of a tiring Australian attack. This time Pujara flicks it away and he will look to get. This time he might be gone. They're appealing for a run out. And Patrick Cummins, who is a brilliant fielder, they look confident that Pujara has got the... They have got their man Pujara. This time it may not work, as he tried to go for 2 runs, but he might be gone. A brilliant one-handed flick and Pujara is in trouble. He is gone. He is gone by a mile. He was not even in the picture. So Pujara's brilliant innings comes to an end courtesy a stunning run out by the fast bowler Patrick Cummins, who bowled more than 20 overs and gets Pujara, who goes after a standing ovation for a brilliant 123. India are now 9/250 at 87.5 over. So we have come to the end of day's play. It has been a session which has been shared by both teams. Australia have managed to get Pujara run out on the last ball of the day, and at 87.5 overs, 250 for 9 might just look respectable as compared to what we saw in the opening overs of the day. So thank you for listening. I will be back tomorrow with more analysis on the same. Good night.